Hello all. I welcome you in the Daware's Legal Rostrum, the lecture series. So since past few months, we are organizing different kinds of lecture series to aware society in regards to the legal rights, their legal obligation, and the legal norms which we are under obligation to follow to maintain the dignity of the society. So we have organized lecture series on the IPC and the protection of a woman under the Indian Penal Code, the IPC and the woman safety, the IPC and the POCSO, which is the protection of children from sexual abuses. And we have also organized a lecture series on right to know, which was named as the Right to Information Act lecture series. We have also organized a lecture series on domestic violence laws. So, today is the topic, which is also in relation to the safety of a woman. So, today's topic is very serious and it is more concerned about the prevention of sexual harassment of women at workplaces. As we generally observe, there is a huge crowd which go to the corporates, and generally the women's group is more in the corporate bodies or any other institutions, as we are more woman empowerment oriented policy has declared by the government agencies. The more woman crowd which we can see in the corporates or the financial institutions or in the working institutions or such as schools and colleges and any other social organization, we can observe working class of women. So the question arises, what about their safety at particularly workplaces? What we can do about their safety at workplaces? So basically, this is a fact which nobody can deny. Since ancient times, the woman faces always she is facing the sexual exploitation problem, which is still exist in the society, which we cannot deny. So what we can do in certain cases, what we can analyze to solve their problem, that is the topic of today's lecture. So we are going to talk about the prevention of sexual abuses, particularly at workplaces. If any incident which exploits women's dignity, they have their own particular remedy at the society. But what about if the incident happens in the corporate bodies or any other institutions in which the woman is working? What are their rights? What are her rights? So today's lectures main motive is to aware women about their safety, about their legal rights, about their legal the safety in the working employment nature. So by starting the topic, we will move certain slides. So we will be more concerned about the prevention of sexual harassment of women, of particularly women at workplaces, and preventive or the protective statutes on that. So we will be discussing the same in the further lecture. So, by starting with the brief introduction about the woman safety at workplaces. So, what had happened in the past that in the year of 1997, one working class of women approached the Supreme Court of India and they had filed a petition under Article 32 in the Honorable Supreme Court, which was in the form of public interest litigation. The litigant's name was the Vishakha versus the state of Rajasthan. What was the facts of the case? The facts of the case, case was the one aggrieved lady, which had named that Bhavari Devi. The Bhavari Devi, who was a social activist, had gang raped by some social enemies. The Bhavari Devi was a social worker and she had opposed to the child marriage. And due to her oppose, some accused persons of the social enemies, they had raped her brutally. So aggrieved by this incident, the Bhavari Devi had lodged the, as usual, the complaint in the police station. But what had happened in this case, that in the trial court, the accused person was acquitted by the concerned court and aggrieved by this decision, and to prevent such kind of incident in the future, some working class of the woman approached the Supreme Court, and the Vishakha and the other versus state of Rajasthan case had filed in the form of public interest litigation. In this case, the Supreme Court of India took the cognizance of the case, obviously, and passed some guidelines to prevent such kind of incidences in the workplaces, particularly in the workplaces. So this was the brief introduction about the preventive action of sexual harassment at workplaces. So this was the history of the enactment, which was later on enacted by the parliament, which was in the name of the Sexual Harassment Prevention and prevention and the cure of the such kind of sexual harassment at workplaces, which was later on enacted by the parliament. So this was the brief history. So in the case of Vishakha versus state of Rajasthan, the Supreme Court of India gave some guidelines. So few guidelines are, it was laid down in the judgment above mentioned, that it is the duty of the employer or other responsible persons in workplaces or other institutions to prevent the happening of such event. Such event means sexual harassment. It was also gave guidelines to the employer to furnish the employee with effective mechanism for the process of resolving or trying of such indecent acts of sexual harassment. And in this particular judgment, the Honorable Supreme Court of India had defined the word sexual harassment. The definition was given by the Supreme Court of India, which was like, the sexual harassment means disagreeable, sexually determined behavior, direct or indirect, as physical contact and advances. First was what? Physical contact and advances, which was included in the term of sexual harassment. So, second meaning of sexual harassment was a demand or request for sexual favors. Third was sexually colored remarks or the signals, which we can in generally elaborate this thing, that sexually colored signals given to the woman. Third was showing pornography. And the last was any other unwelcome physical, verbal or non-verbal conduct of sexual nature. Any act which is indecent in nature, which is considered as sexual or the sexual exploitation, included, was included and is included in the sexual harassment terminology. So the widest definition and the inclusive definition was given by the Supreme Court of India in the case of Vishakha versus State of Rajasthan. So not only this Prevention of Sexual Harassment at Workplaces Act or the statute gives the only remedy to the woman, there is another act which applies to the whole of India now, which is the Indian Penal Code 1860. Any woman aggrieved by the sexual harassment or the sexual exploitation by the co-worker or the managerial person or the another any kind of accused employee, she has a remedy, a general remedy. She can directly go to the police station without any interference of working managerial persons. She can directly approach to the police stations. Okay, so the IPC gives total protection to the working woman in the form of zero FIR, in the form of direct FIR, in the form of non-cognizable complaints, in the form of private complaints. The working woman has these kind of remedies, which are general in nature, which are applicable to all, which generally protects to all citizens of India, or the all individuals, or the all persons which are residing in India. So the protection of the protection of a woman from sexual abuses at workplaces, or the statutes thereon, are not only the statutes which generally protects the woman from sexual abuses. So IPC is there. IPC 1860 protects each and every citizen in the country. Okay. So by moving further, which we have already discussed about the definition of sexual harassment, which was declared by the Supreme Court of India in the judgment of Vishakha versus State of Rajasthan. So, in the year of 1997, the Supreme Court of India gave guidelines to the government to protect women at workplaces in the offenses of sexual harassment or in the offenses of sexual exploitation at workplaces. So, after the year of 1997, in the year of 2013, the government of India enacted one specific act which could deal with the sexual harassment at workplaces. So the act was named as Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Prevention, Prohibition and Redressal Act 2013. Three main terminologies given under this act. One was prevention, the act or the offense must be prevented. Second was prohibition, the act or the offense must be prohibited by law. And third was the redressal. If any such incident happens, what kind of redressal we can give to the woman? So three main objectives given under this act. One is prevention, second is prohibition, and third is redressal. Okay, so in the year of 2013, the parliament enacted the sexual harassment of women at workplaces, prevention, prohibition, and redressal act 2013. So what kind of legal remedies available to the woman specifically in this concerned statute? The first is she can lodge a complaint to the internal committee. There are various committees given under the statute. First is internal committee. She can directly approach or she can directly give her grievances to the internal committee. And the internal committee, upon working, will be liable to give such kind of punishment to the accused person. Okay, so there are other committees as well. We will be talking about later on. So first, we will be discuss this in the notes section. So we will note down everything which we have discussed as of now in the notes section. So the first thing we have discussed that definition of sexual harassment. Okay. Second, which we have discussed is the Vishakha versus State of Rajasthan. Three main objectives. Prevention, that is second was prohibition. and third was redressal. So these are the things which we have discussed as of now. So let's move further. So to discuss legal remedies for women given under the statute, we will be directly moving to the concerned statute now. So this is the statute which prevents, prohibits and gives redressal to the offences given under this act. To go through the concerned statute, we'll first see the preamble of the act, which says that we can highlight this. What was the main objective or the main aim of the statute is provided under the preamble. Okay, so what it does says that an act to provide protection against sexual harassment of women. I'm reading it slowly just to understand you the whole concept or the whole terminology or the whole objective given under the preamble. What was the intention of the parliament to pass such kind of enactment in favor of women? So the preamble provides that an act to provide protection against sexual harassment of women at workplace. Okay, sexual to protect, to prevent sexual harassment at workplaces, and for the prevention and redressal of complaints of sexual harassment and for matters connected thereto and incidental therewith. Okay, so as we have already discussed in the lectures notes column, what we have discussed, the main motive behind passing such kind of enactment was, or the main intention behind passing such kind of enactment was to prevent, to prohibit, or to give redressal such kind of enactment or such kind of offenses provided under the statute. To prevent offenses given under the same statute, to prohibit such kind of offenses given under the same statute, or to give redressal to the grievances raised by the woman. Okay, so this is the explanation about the preamble. Okay, so not only the Supreme Court of India gave or the highlighted this kind of incidences or the give protection to the woman in this particular case, there was a treaty which was ratified by the Union of India, which was named as the International Convention and Instruments such as Convention on the elimination of all forms of discrimination against women, which was ratified by the Union of India on the 25th of June 1993. Okay, this was the treaty, international treaty, was executed between the international organizations or the international states or the international basically we can say bodies and the Union of India. Okay, so in the year of 1993, the International Convention was the international treaty was ratified between the the United Nations organizations and the India. Okay, so the Constitution of India also gave rights, which we commonly known as the fundamental rights, which are applicable and protects to each and every citizens of India. So what are the articles given under the Constitution which protects the citizens, or particularly, or we can say, which also protects the woman? The articles are Article 14, which says that every citizen of India will have equal protection of laws and equal protection of laws and equality before the law. Article 15 says that no person shall be discriminated on the grounds of sex, on the grounds of social background, their caste, their religion, their race. So Article 15 prohibits the discrimination on these grounds. Article 21 says that each and every person residing in the country or the residing in the India will have a right to live with dignity. Now the term dignity has a wide scope, and it was defined time to time by the Supreme Court of India. And nowadays, the life to live with dignity includes each and everything which facilitates a person to live or enjoy their life fully or enjoy their freedom without interference of others. Okay, so this is the common terminologies given under this statute. Okay, so these are some backgrounds which encouraged to Parliament to enact such kind of laws to protect women from sexual abuses at workplaces. Okay, so we'll go through the preliminary chapter, okay, which is named as Chapter 1. This act extends to the whole of India nowadays, after removing or the altering or the amending the Article 370 from the Constitution of India. Each and every act enacted in the state of India or the Union of India is applicable to the whole territory of India. Okay, earlier days it was like few acts or some acts were not applicable to the state of Jammu and Kashmir, but nowadays it is applicable to the whole of India. Okay, so definitions given under this act: aggrieved woman, who is aggrieved woman? In relation to a workplace, a woman of any age, whether employed or not. I am out to say you that this act is an inclusive of nature. It does not exclude anything. It includes everything, literally everything. We can see in the later on, but in the definition of aggrieved woman, what does it says? In relation to a workplace, who is aggrieved woman? Woman of any age, whether employed or not, who alleges to have been subjected to any act of sexual harassment by the respondent. Okay. If any woman, whether she is employed or not, if she alleges that the respondent has committed some kind of sexual harassment on me, that will be an aggrieved woman under the definition of the aggrieved woman. Okay. In relation to dwelling place or house, woman of any age who is employed in such dwelling place or house. Suppose a maid. She is employed in the house. Okay. So under the category or under the definition of aggrieved woman, she is also included. Okay. So I have already told you that the statute is of inclusive nature. It does not exclude anything. To protect a woman from the sexual abuses, it included everything, literally everything. We will observe this inclusion in the further. As we have already discussed about the appropriate government in the previous lectures as well. If you want to understand what is appropriate government, you will have to go through the previous lectures. So we will not focus on the appropriate government now. We will move further. There are some definitions given about chairperson, district officer, domestic worker, employee. Now, domestic worker and the employee will be the main or the highlighted definitions in this part. So we will understand what is domestic worker or who comes under the category of domestic worker. Okay. So as the definition says, the domestic worker means a woman who is employed to do the household work. As we have already discussed, the maid, the example of maid. The woman who is employed to do the household work in any household or in any household for remuneration, whether in cash or kind. Okay. Either directly or through any agency on temporary or permanent, whether it is part-time or full-time. But it does not include any member of the family of the employer. Understood the definition? Any other outsider woman who is employed to do the household work, whether it is permanent, whether it is temporary, whether it was by agency, whether it was on contract basis, that is inconsistent. If you have hired a woman to do household work, that will come under the category of domestic worker. But there is an exception that the domestic worker does not include the member of the family of the employer. Okay. Second is employee. The employee means a person employed at a workplace for any work on regular, temporary, ad hoc. Ad hoc means for short term. Okay. Or daily wage basis, either directly or through an agent, including a contractor with or without the knowledge of the principal employer, whether for remuneration or not, or working on voluntary basis or otherwise. That is inconsistent. If you hired an employee on the, whether it is contract basis or whether it was an agency basis, whether it was for short term, whether it was for temporary basis, that is inconsistent. Whether the terms of employment are expressed or implied and includes a co-worker, a contract worker, probationer, trainee, apprentice, or called by any other such name. Now you can see how much inclusion the parliament has made in this enactment. Okay, the employee includes the temporary workman, or the ad hoc employee, or the permanent or the contract basis employee, or the agency basis employee, or the whether the employee was working for the remuneration or not. That was inconsistent. Okay. And it also includes the co-worker, a contract worker, a probationer, a trainee, apprentice, or any other name which we can call as an employee. Okay. Any other person which we can call as an employee comes under the category of, or the comes under the definition of employee. Okay. Employer, in any relation, it means in relation to any department, organization, undertaking, establishment, enterprise, institution, office, branch, or unit of the appropriate government or a local authority, the head of the department. Okay, employer. Employer means who? In relation to department, organization, undertaking, establishment, enterprise, institution, office, branch, or unit of the appropriate government or the local authority, which substantially controlled by the government, who will be the employer then? The head of the department. Head of that particular department will be the employer. Okay. In any workplace not covered under subclause 1, any person responsible for the management, supervision and control of the workplace. Okay. In any other private institutions, who will be considered as an employer? Suppose I am working in the private company and I am general employee there. So who will be employer for me? My manager, obviously. My manager will be the employer for me. The manager generally has power to do management, to do supervision, and to control their working group. Okay. So there has given some other definitions as well, such as internal committee, local committee, member, prescribed. Now prescribed means prescribed by rules. Member, local committees, internal committees, we will be discussing further. Okay, presiding officers, respondent means a person against whom the aggrieved person has made a complaint. Okay. Now, as we have already discussed, we will not focus much on this topic. That's sexual harassment. We have already discussed previously what is sexual harassment. Sexual harassment includes any one or more of the following unwelcome acts or behavior, whether directly or by implication, namely physical contact and advances, or a demand or request for sexual favors, or making sexually colored remarks or the acts, showing pornography, any other unwelcome physical, verbal or non-verbal conduct of sexual nature. Okay. Workplace, as we have already discussed. Workplace includes any department, organization, undertaking, establishment, enterprise, institution, office, branch or unit, which is owned, controlled, substantially managed by the government directly or indirectly. Or it also includes any private sector organization or private venture, undertaking, enterprise, institutions, establishment, society, trust, non-governmental organization, unit or service provider carrying on commercial, professional, vocational, educational, entertainmental, industrial, health services or financial activities, including production, supply, sale, distribution or service. Okay. So literally all kinds of, you know, the services or the departments or the organizations have been included in the category of workplace. Okay. Any place visited by the employee arising out of or during the course of employment, including transportation by the employer for undertaking such journey. Okay. Second is dwelling place or house. In the example of maid, the dwelling place or the house will be the workplace. Unorganized sector in relation to a workplace means an enterprise owned by individuals or self-owned workers and engaged in the production or sale of goods or providing service of any kind of whatsoever, and where the enterprise employs workers, the number of such workers is less than 10. Unorganized sector has been given under the concern statute definition part. The prevention of sexual harassment, the main provision which gives tooth to the enactment, that is section 3. Section 3 prevents sexual harassment. Okay. So, what does it say? No woman shall be subjected to the sexual harassment at any workplace. Prohibits, it prevents the sexual harassment. Okay. These are some provisions given which may amount to the sexual harassment, which can be, first is implied or explicit promise of preferential treatment in her employment, or implied or explicit threat of detrimental treatment in her employment, or implied or explicit threat of her present or future employment status, or interference with her work, or creating an intimidating or offensive or hostile work environment for her, or humiliating treatment likely to affect her health or safety. It may arise to the offense, or it may amount to the sexual harassment, which is given under the section 3. So chapter 2 provides the constitution of internal complaints committee, which we have already discussed, the internal committee, the most commonly known as internal committee. So let's see what does it says. Every employer of workplace shall by an order in writing constitute a committee to be known as the internal complaints committee. Okay. So internal complaints committee shall be comprised with the officers, which is prescribed in this statute only. There will be members in the internal committee, complaint committee, formulated by the employer itself, and the members therein will formulate a policy to prevent sexual harassment. Okay. Now, constitution of local complaints committee. Okay. Now, internal, what is the difference between the internal committee, internal complaints committee, and the local complaints committee? The internal complaints committee basically and generally formulated by the employer by itself. Okay. And the local complaints committee is formulated or constituted by the local authority of that district. Okay. So the difference between the two is, the main difference is, the internal complaints committee is basically a private committee, and the local complaints committee is the government committee. Okay. Notification of district officer. Now, who is the district officer under this enactment? Is district officer means the judicial magistrate first class. That means generally a magistrate, district magistrate, or the executive magistrate, or the district collector, or the deputy collector of the district is generally will treat as a district officer. Okay. So these are some irrelevant provisions given. Composition, tenure, and other terms and conditions not relevant in this lecture. Grants and audit. So chapter 4 is more important in regards to the sexual harassment complaints. Okay. So section 9 deals with the complaint of sexual harassment. Any aggrieved woman can file a complaint with the internal committee or to the local complaints committee. Where the internal complaint committee is not in existence, the aggrieved woman can approach to the local complaints committee. Okay. So within how many period she has to file a complaint? So the provision says that within a period of 3 months, she has to file a complaint to the either to the local either to the internal complaints committee or the local complaints committee. Okay. So if how what will happen if the limitation period provided under this act is expired. So what is the remedy available to the aggrieved person? What the aggrieved woman? Suppose I am an aggrieved woman and I don't file a complaint within a period of 3 months. So what I can do if I want to file a complaint further beyond the period of 3 months? So remedy available in this enactment is I can file a complaint after a period of 3 months as well, provided I should provide a substantial reasons for not approaching a internal complaint committee or the local complaints committee within a period of 3 months. By giving substantial reasonings, the district officers, which are empowered under the local complaints committee or the internal committee chairperson, has empowered to allow such kind of complaints after the period of 3 months as well. Okay. Conciliation, section 10 says about the conciliation. So what kind of conciliation the provision talking about? If the matter, if the aggrieved woman wants to settle the matter peacefully, so the provision, the conciliation provision helps to settle the matter internally without approaching the local complaints committee. The internal complaints committee can do conciliation between the aggrieved woman and the respondent. What kind of conciliation is allowed in this provision? Any conciliation which settles the matter is allowed in this provision, except the monetary conciliation. The monetary conciliation is expressly prohibited from the conciliation provision. Suppose I want to settle the matter peacefully and through the conciliation proceedings, I cannot settle the matter by taking monetary compensation. Okay. So conciliation proceedings is not for that. Any other matter, we can settle it by conciliation proceeding, which comes under the category of sexual harassment. Inquiry into complaint. After receiving the complaint of sexual harassment, the internal complaints committee or the local complaints committee are empowered to inquire into such complaints, whether it is fraud, whether it is true or whether it is false complaint. Okay, so after due inquiry taken place by the internal committee or the local complaints committee, the proper punishment and the appropriate punishment will be awarded to the accused person or the respondent. Okay. Action during pendency of inquiry. What kind of action the internal complaints committee or the local complaints committee are empowered to do? The local complaints committee or the internal complaints committee can grant a leave to the aggrieved woman, which is extended to the 3 months. Okay. Or temporary nature. The internal complaints committee can transfer such aggrieved woman to another workplace for her safety. Okay. Or any other relief which in the interest of justice, the appropriate internal complaints committee or the local complaints committee deems fit, they can award such kind of relief to the aggrieved woman. Okay, inquiry report. Every inquiry report formulated by the internal complaints committee, the internal complaints committee have to forward such kind of inquiry report to the local complaints committee. Okay. So now the forged complaints. So basically we observe in the society, most of the time it happens that to take revenge of such employee or the such co-worker, it happens that the aggrieved woman it might be not aggrieved by such incidences, deliberately files the false complaint before the internal complaint committee or the local complaints committee to determine such kind of cases, or to determine whether it is a false complaint or true complaint, or whether it is genuine or bona fide complaints given by the aggrieved woman, the internal committee or the local complaints committee is empowered to analyze the same. Okay, after analyzing, the section says that after analyzing, suppose the complaint discovers that the complaint is false, or the complaint is fraudulently filed by the aggrieved woman, the aggrieved woman will face the disciplinary action, or it includes the retrenchment of such woman, or punishment, any other punishment which may be deemed fit in the eyes of interest of the justice. Okay, any kind of punishment may be awarded in the which is reasonable in nature to the false complainant. Okay, determination of compensation. What factors do the internal complaint committee takes into the consideration, or the complaint local complaints committee takes